Good evening, everybody, and welcome to Realizing the American Dream. This is a show we talk about mortgage stuff and anything that's kind of peripheral to that, including interest rates, economics, all kinds of good stuff. So tonight, what I'm going to focus on is actually, I'm going to do some comparing and contrasting. And this is actually being fed into by, you know, what's going on over the last couple of weeks and kind of where the economy is going. So you'll see what I'm talking about as soon as I get into it. So what did happen in the news? Well, there was obviously an election, and that turned out some people are happy, some people not so happy. I think it's about an even split there. But what's happening in the market, which is the thing that I'm concerned with, is it's driving interest rates upward. And the reason for that, if you ever watched this show before, you ever pay attention to economics, you realize that interest rates for mortgages are basically based upon the selling of bonds on the secondary market called mortgage-backed securities. Now, the mortgage-backed securities are a competing investment with the stock market. So what normally happens, except in rare cases, is when stocks go up, the price of these mortgage-backed securities actually goes down because it's a competing investment. So when that happens, it drives the interest rate or the returns up on them. And this is what all the mortgage rates are based off of. A lot of people think it's the Federal Reserve rate and things that the Fed does. To a degree, that does have an effect because it actually, everything's tied. So if you're looking at other competing investments, which would be the treasury bills and things like that, you may know them as U.S. savings bonds, things like that. So that'll influence the rates also, but strictly or standardly, they're influenced mostly by the mortgage-backed securities. So I had somebody last week whose rate lock was expiring, and I told them they had to get their settlement in prior to the rate lock expiring. They weren't quite ready to settle yet. I told them interest rates were going up, and they said, well, you can blame Donald Trump for that. Here's the scoop. So actually, interest rates going up, as you know, some people may perceive this as a bad thing, but it's actually a good thing, because normally interest rates going up is an indicator of the economy getting better. Now, the economy isn't actually getting better yet. Slightly, I mean, there's some positive things out there, but for the most part, this is proactive thinking on this part of the stock market. After the election was over, the stock market during the night, I don't know if anybody was watching this, I was up till 2:30 in the morning, the Dow futures were off like 900 points. By the next day, they were up 250. That's an 1150 point swing within less than 24 hours. And since then, the market is up about 900 to 1,000 points. That is because the stock traders think that the economy is going to be going in a positive direction. I hope that's true. You know, as nice as it is to have low interest rates, and they're still very low, they're still at 40-year lows, it's even nicer to have a recovering economy, which is good for everybody, not just people who are doing refinancing or purchasing a car. So that's kind of where we are. So what that leads into is, now, what is your best bet for your personal finance as far as financing property? And that's what I want to do. I want to contrast tonight and compare home equity lines of credit, adjustable rate mortgages, fixed rate mortgages, and see what makes sense. And I'm going to give you guys some risk things as well as some pros and cons of all of those. And then you can make your own decision, because a lot of this has to do with the term and how long you think you might have these loans outstanding. But at the same time, you know, there's other market conditions that do have an influence. So without any further yapping on my part, let's go over to the board and we'll talk about this. All right, so what I'm going to start with, first of all, home equity line versus mortgage ARM. I kind of included the mortgage and ARM as the same thing because it's both different kinds of mortgages. But in some cases, again, the consideration as to whether you want to go with a fixed rate mortgage or an adjustable rate mortgage is going to play into this. And again, your timing and what you're going to use the loan for. So when it comes down to home equity line of credit, usually the driving factor here is people are trying to avoid closing costs, because most times home equity lines of credit do not have any closing costs. Now, there are some that do carry them. It depends on the bank. It depends on what you're going to use it for. If you're doing a swing loan, for example, where it's going to be a short-term loan, it's just a special kind of home equity line of credit, the bank knows that you're going to be paying the loan off early. So what it does is it may charge you an upfront fee just to compensate for some of the costs that it has to originate the loan. And even though, you know, it's just a home equity line of credit, there still are costs, because the bank still does a title search. They do an appraisal. Even if it's a drive-by online, there still is cost involved in all of that. So, but in a normal case, there's normally zero cost for the home equity line of credit. A mortgage, if you're originating a new mortgage, not including your, your escrows or what they call prepaids, prepaid interest, prepaid taxes, things like that, down payment money if it's a purchase, just the regular closing costs for title insurance, the application fee, processing fees, appraisal, all that stuff, you're looking at probably $2,000 to $5,000 cost to originate a new mortgage. So all that being said, and most people might go, well, you know, then, you know, with all that cost, you might as well just go with the home equity. But that's not necessarily the case, because you will make up for that over time, especially depending on what your loan amount is, how long you're going to hold the loan, and a number of other factors, which we're going to get into in preceding pages. Moving over here. So flexibility. I want to address flexibility here, because that's really one of the big things that it's the difference between the mortgage and the home equity line of credit. Home equity line is more flexible in some aspects. So for example, it's basically a revolving line. What a revolving line is like a credit card. You can draw on it, you can pay it down to zero, you can draw on it again, it stays open. Normal home equity line of credit have a 15-year draw period, and then some of them have a certain amount of time to pay it back. That draw period does come to an end though, but you can draw money, you know, on and off it, pay it down. If it sits at zero, sometimes there's a fee for non-activity, but other than that, it's a pretty simple concept. It just, you know, you pay interest when you have money outstanding. If you have no money outstanding, it's not costing you anything. Flexibility, payment, the home equity lines normally still offer either interest only or principal and interest. For some people, that's nice. If you're just looking at a cash flow mechanism, interest only obviously keeps your payment way down. It doesn't pay down in the principal, but it keeps the payment nice and low. Some people just prefer to have principal and interest because you always want to be whittling away at principal. A lot of people will use this. People that have bonus in their pay, they'll just go interest only, and then every year they may slap, you know, a big chunk down on it, maybe throw 10 grand at it, whatever, or pay it off. So it just depends, again, on your usage and how you plan on paying this thing, what the best bet is for you. Standardly, when I do the home equity lines for a swing loan, for example, if you don't have your existing home sold and you're gonna be buying a new house, I set the swing loans up with interest only. The reason I do that is because I know it's short term and you have to worry about paying down on the principal because you're gonna pay it off when the house sells. But at the same time, it minimizes your payment until your existing house sells, because now you're gonna be carrying the expense of two homes. So again, all comes down to the purpose. Also, flexibility, when I say balance, what I mean there is the payment is based on the outstanding balance on the line of credit. So if you have nothing outstanding, you have no payment. If you have $100, then you have a small payment. If you have $10,000, your payment's a little bigger. You can use it as a cash flow mechanism. So what you can do is, you know, as you pay the balance up and down, your minimum payment will go up and down too. That's the same for interest only or principal and interest. Just obviously, interest only is always going to be a little bit lower. Coming down to the mortgage, you don't normally have the option of interest only on those anymore. Most places do not offer that interest only. Some do. It's not a blanket statement that it's not out there. But in most cases, the standard Fannie Freddie stuff is all principal and interest payment. So that's what's out there. Fixed amount, as far as the mortgage itself, once you take a certain amount out on a mortgage, that's what you have to work with. You can't usually go back and draw more on a mortgage unless you originate a new mortgage. So it's not like the home equity, like a revolving line. This is more of an installment, what they call an installment type loan. You borrow an amount, you make payments to it, you pay it back. Once it's paid off, you're done with it. You can't draw on it again. So again, not as much flexibility as the home equity line. More programs, there's generally more programs available. I included things like renovation, purchase. Normally, a home equity line cannot be used for a purchase situation. The reason for that, especially if it's a primary residence, when you have a home equity line of credit, or even if you refinance a primary mortgage on your primary home, there's a 3-day right of rescission. That becomes a problem for a seller if you purchase the house from them, but they can't get their money until 3 days after settlement because of this rescission period. And during that rescission period, you could move into the house and then cancel your loan out, and then the seller gets nothing and you're in the house, and it's very difficult to get people out. So they normally do not allow home equity lines for purchase situations. As far as other programs, there's just a whole lot of flexibility out there as far as down payment, things like that. There's a ton of programs for mortgages, first-time homebuyer programs, discounted programs, the ARMs, everything. So there's a ton of programs for that. HELOC, again, it's just basically a revolving line of credit. So that's all you have to work with there. You can do renovation. One of the nice things about a renovation loan, and you can use home equity line of credit for renovation too. It's just when you do the home equity line of credit, you have to use the existing value as is. The renovation loans on a mortgage, normally what we would do is do a loan where you're basing everything on proposed value. So if your house is worth $200,000 now, but you're doing a $100,000 addition, you may not have the equity to draw the extra $100,000 out to do the addition. However, if you base it on the value after the addition is added, so let's just say that value is now $275,000 or $300,000, you have a lot more flexibility there. You have a lot more equity to borrow on. So again, that's a flexibility factor for the mortgage in doing a renovation loan. Also, you can do a mortgage and a home equity line. There are some places that will allow you to have second and third liens with home equity lines and stack these things, but not most of them. So this one, you can have a mortgage and then you can add a home equity line on afterwards. So there are some flexibilities there as far as drawing extra cash out or doing other things. And then the purchase situation we already talked about. Again, you can use the mortgage for purchase or refinance or cash out or renovation or any of those things. All right. Risk factors. I want to talk about risk factors because this is really the big part of why I decided to do this show today, because with the market finally starting to recover and finally starting to push upwards, interest rates are up 0.5% since the election. That's just the regular mortgage rates. Prime rate has not moved yet, but the Federal Reserve will start moving rates very soon. If not in December, I'm guessing the first quarter of next year. How quickly they move that will depend on where the economy goes and how quickly it moves. But as the Fed moves its rates, that will adjust prime rate. Most of the home equity lines of credit are based upon prime rate plus a margin of some kind. That margin is determined by a bunch of other stuff, and we're going to get into that on the next page. But as that prime rate moves, this is like an adjustable rate mortgage. As the prime rate moves, your interest rate moves. Now, the thing that happens with the home equity line, unlike a mortgage, in most cases, the home equity line, I put monthly here, but it can move immediately. So if the Federal Reserve comes out and says, all right, yeah, we're jumping rates 0.5%, your prime rate jumps 0.5%, your overall total rate jumps 0.5%, you know, you could see a pretty big change in your payment pretty quickly when that starts to happen. So something to be aware of. The historical average of prime, I think prime is at 3.5% right now. The historical average of prime, if you take out the last couple of years, because it's been held low because of quantitative easing and all the monetary policy of the Fed, so it's not normal times. But if you start looking over the last 30 years prior to that, historical average of prime is around 6.75%. So locking into a fixed rate loan, if you have a home equity line, because I know a lot of people out there that have gone and done home equity lines, paid off their mortgage, went to a home equity line at say 3%, or they may be sitting right at prime, and they're going, all right, you know, I have prime now, and they've had it for the last 3 or 4 years maybe, paid no closing costs, may have been a great deal. But now as rates start to push up, those rates are gonna start to move. So you may wanna think about trying to fix your loan, pay off your home equity line of credit and maybe roll it into a 15-year mortgage. Rates on the 15-year mortgage are still below prime right now. So if you're prime or prime plus a margin, you could probably refinance into a 15-year fixed rate mortgage and still get a better rate than what you have currently on your home equity line of credit, which is adjustable. So yes, you have the closing costs, but if you have the equity, you can roll them into the loan. So no big deal there, but at least it'll fix the rate and protect you from the markets pushing up. Interest only and principal and interest. I mentioned earlier that the home equity lines of credit do allow you in many cases to do interest only payments. That's great for a period, but that doesn't last forever. Home equity lines will allow interest only up to a certain point. When the draw period ends, then you must start paying principal and interest. This is where you can get stuck also. Not only will rates be going up because of prime rate changing, but if your loan rolls into principal and interest from just interest only, and let's just say you've got $200,000 outstanding on your loan from paying off a mortgage, you could see a $400 or $500 a month increase like that almost instantly. That's not even considering the prime rate moving. So you start to couple these things and we could see a lot of people getting in trouble. So think about this. If you have a home equity line of credit and no mortgage and there's a substantial balance on it, you need to be aware of this and think about it right now. Mortgages, as far as risk, just a regular fixed rate mortgage, there's not a whole lot of risk there. You know, again, it's not going to change. The only thing that can change really in your payment is going to be your escrow if you have it, which will be your taxes and insurance. And yes, that goes up almost every year, but that's a minimal amount really. So fixed rate mortgage, you're not going to see much moving. The ARMs, however, again, something to pay attention to, because intermediate term ARMs have a fixed period. So if you're looking at a 5-1 ARM, for example, and you got a great rate up front, it's fixed for 5 years, it's a 30-year amortization, you're loving your payment, you're loving your life, except when you get to year six, and now interest rates have gone up, and year six, your loan adjusts a substantial amount. Again, be aware of that. Be proactive. Lock into a fixed rate now if you think you're going to be holding the loan a longer period than that fixed term that you've already got, because you don't want to get that sticker shock. Even though in some cases I've refinanced people whose rates have gone up, somebody may be sitting in a 5-1 ARM at 3%, and they're locking in at like 3.5% on a 30-year fixed, but knowing that most likely within the next, you know, however many months or whenever that loan goes to adjust, you may be seeing 4.5%, 5%, and the next adjustment you could be seeing 6%, 7%. Who knows? You don't know where the rates are going to go. It will pay for itself in the long run. So if you think you're going to be there 2 or 3 years past that ending of that fixed term, then you probably want to do something with it. If you know you're getting out of the property, you're selling it, you're paying it off, don't worry about it. But it's definitely something you might want to talk to a loan officer about, just to understand your options. When this thing does adjust, it's going to adjust with the index and the margin. Pretty much the same here. The index on the home equity line of credit is prime rate. The index on most mortgages is going to be LIBOR. Sometimes it's the treasury bill. Sometimes it's prime. But it's usually one of the other factors that are a little more stable. But all that being said, there's still an adjustment, and it's still very similar in how they calculate the new payment. The nice thing about that is on the mortgage, it's only annual, so it can't happen monthly. So you're kind of insulated from some of the shifting of the market. You'll adjust once a year on your anniversary, and then your payment is that for the next year. And one of the nice things about this too is you can make it a cash flow tool. If you have big bonuses coming in, you can pay down the ARM, and then when your payment does go to adjust, it's based upon the outstanding principal balance and the new rate and the amount of term left. So even if your rate goes up, if you paid the loan down substantially, your payment may still go down, but you still want to be aware you might be able to get a better deal by fixing your rate at some point in time, even with the closing costs. All right, coming over here. Pricing on these things, home equity line. Standardly, the pricing is only based on a couple of things. It's based on credit sometimes, not usually. Usually it's either a yes or a no on credit. If you're below a certain level, they don't have the Fannie Freddie risk-based pricing adjustments. But on home equity lines, lien position is a big one. If it's a first lien where you have no other loans against the property, the payments or the interest rate is going to be a little bit lower. If it's in second lien or third lien, it's going to be higher. Or if it's non-owner occupied, that's the other one, occupancy status, it's going to be higher. So these things will influence what your rate is. Again, mortgages have adjustments, pricing adjustments, fees and rate. Home equity lines, not so much. It's just usually that the margin that's adjusted. So they'll keep prime rate as the index, but the margin is going to be adjusted based upon these things. Loan amount also is a factor. So a lot of times if you're borrowing up to $25,000, that's one thing. If you're $25,000 to $100,000, that's another. If you're $100,000 to $200,000, that's another. So the amount of the loan does have an effect on it. And again, like I said, occupancy status. If it's a owner-occupied property, you're going to get the best rate. If it's not, it's going to cost you a little bit more because that is considered a little more risk. Down here, mortgages, the way they're priced out. FICO, that's your credit score. Again, that's a big influencer of the mortgage. It does not have anything to do with the HELOC usually, but it is a big thing here. Term, the home equity lines of credit, like I said, they have a draw period and a pay period. Mortgages, again, more flexibility with the term. I forgot to mention that in the other screen. But you can do anything from 10-year, 15-year, 20-year, 25-year, 30-year. The term, normally the shorter the term on a mortgage, the lower the interest rate's going to be. Because it's, again, if you're paying it off in a shorter term, it's considered less risk because the bank doesn't have as much exposure to interest rate fluctuations. Occupancy status, same as up here. If it's not owner occupied, second home, that's going to influence what the interest rate or the pricing is going to be. Purpose of the loan, that also will have an influence. For example, if you're just doing a rate and term refi where you're just paying off your existing loan, that's the least risky thing. If you are doing cash out and now you're drawing extra cash out to do something else or pay off other debt, that becomes a little more risky. If you're using it to buy an investment property, again, a little more risky. So it just depends on what you're using it for. Renovation, again, you know, any of these things add layers of risk to it and also add to the interest rate of the pricing. Lien status, the mortgage always has to be in first lien position. However, if you've got a second lien with a balance on it, Fannie and Freddie see that as a little more risky loan because now you've got two loans to pay on. If you've got a second lien with no balance, there's usually no adjustments. But if you have a second lien and you've got an existing balance on it, you're going to see a higher pricing adjustment than you would otherwise, whether it's in points or rate or however it's applied. But there is an adjustment for that. And also loan type. The interest rates on the mortgage and the pricing, ARMs usually come in a little bit cheaper. They give you a discount on those. Again, that's a risk factor. What happens is the bank, if they give you a 5-year ARM and the rate is fixed at a certain level for 5 years, then it becomes adjustable, the bank does not have as much exposure to interest rate fluctuations as it would if you did a 30-year fixed rate loan. So they give you a little bit of a discount because now the bank knows after 5 years, you've either got to refinance or the rates are going to adjust based on market. And whether they go up or down, if the rate's at market rate, the bank doesn't have as much risk. So that's why I said loan type will affect this also. And I think that is about it. So to wrap up, really what I want to say is if the economy does recover, everybody's kind of hopeful right now. The markets are actually kind of hopeful. So if that does happen, interest rates will necessarily go up. That's good. It's good in the fact that the economy is getting better. Bad in the fact that this stuff's going to cost you a little more, but hopefully you're making more money at your job and you can afford it. And more people have jobs and they can buy houses. So that's all good. That's all I have for right now. Have a great Thanksgiving. I'll see you guys next month and enjoy winter. It just showed up this weekend.